Meet Michael Dupuis. He loves analogies.
Big piece of granite, you just take a hammer and you start knocking the corners off and little bits and pieces at a time.
Mike is in the middle of a 1,000-kilometer bike ride around Georgian Bay, and he's doing it in 9 days on this, an old tandem bike from the 80s with a stick figure named Otto strapped to the back. Otto was a ghost figure, and that means a few things.
Like, the best analogy I could come up with is a mosquito, or let's say a firefly, in a fog storm. And it's behind you, so you can't even see it.
Mike has his reasons for doing this ride, and we'll get to those a bit later. But this isn't a film about biking.
Can you hear me okay? All right. I finished my last dose of treatment today. Everybody thinks it's all done, a Hollywood ending, that this book has been closed. I beat the odds, but the truth is, I don't think this ever ends. So what now? I walked out of the doctor's office in a full-blown daze. It's rush hour and the streets of Hong Kong are bustling. I don't know where to go or what to do. I just sit down and cry. I can't believe these people don't care what just happened to me. I feel invisible. I'm so alone in this. I'm surrounded by millions of people that don't speak my language. An employee at this hotel walked up to me with a full box of Kleenex.
You would think you'd think about the big stuff, but you don't. You just think about some stray thought about, you see something on the road and reminds you of something that happened, and there she is. So it's the little stuff, the day-to-day, what you would normally say non-important stuff, non-eventful. But when they're not there, well, everything is eventful.
On February 22nd, 2013, I moved to Hong Kong for a job and an experience of a lifetime. 5 months and about 100 water buffaloes later, I noticed a bump on the side of my neck, just above my collarbone. Over the next 3 days, the bump turned into a lump. It didn't hurt, but I couldn't ignore it. They said they would call me in 2 days with the results, but they called me the next day. They said it's not good. It's cancer. I thought melanoma was just a mole that could be removed and everything would be fine. I couldn't have been more wrong.
I guess for me it was very much a clinical approach. Like, I understood what she had within probably an hour. You know, when we got home from the diagnosis, I jumped on the internet like everybody else and Googled the heck out of it. And knowing full well that Google's full of good stuff and full of bad stuff, so take it for what it's worth. But everything was pointing in exactly the same direction. So inside of an hour, I already knew I was all gonna go. So you can take a pretty clinical approach to all that, which I suppose is okay in the short term, but Once it's all said and done, you still have to deal with all the other stuff that's hanging around in the background. Morning.
I fly back to Toronto with my tissue samples and petri dishes in my carry-on. I feel like a science experiment. I can't believe I'm leaving in such a hurry. My staff team showed me so much love before I left. It warmed my heart. They made me an origami goose and a paper crane. It's in my carry-on as well.
Is it in your skin? Is it in your bones? All your honor undertow. And there it goes, the middle row. There goes everything I told.
One of the reasons for embarking on this ride is to explore the idea of local cancer support in a rural area. We want to hear people's stories about how they cope. Bob Weeks lost his wife Ginny 8 years ago.
I mean, imagine you've had to deal with a lot of emotions since Ginny's passed away, but did you take time at all while she was going through it to tend to yourself, or is that not even important or relevant?
Well, it didn't happen. Maybe it should have. I know I remember one day in early November, I was at my family doc for some reason, nothing of consequence. And he knew that Ginny was not well. He wasn't her doctor, but he knew she wasn't well. And he was a pilot, and he asked me if I wanted to go flying. I'd love to. And so we went flying for a couple of hours, and it was like somebody had just plucked me out of the world I'd been living in and put me in a different one. It was quite remarkable. So in hindsight, probably I should have had a few occasions when I could say to somebody, would you do the caregiving? I'm going away by myself for a few days, or with my buddies, and we're going to go canoeing or something like that. Right at the end, the last 3 days, I think my son and daughter-in-law had to use injectable morphine to keep the pain down, because the pills weren't doing it. But we slept together the night before she died.
Yeah, that's lovely.
Yeah.
Wow. So any closing words? Does life move on in a different way?
Yeah, life moves on. I mean, you after 37 years, you miss somebody, and it's not every day, but there are moments when you go, oh gee, I wish she were still here. But I have a very good life and a lovely lady friend, and you know, the family's well, and we've got nothing to complain about.
How many donations have you had?
Two so far. Just a couple. People seem to be interested. So.
Are they just from random strangers encounters?
Yeah. You know, they pull you over, make you pull over so they can give you a donation. So we're certainly not going to say no. The sun's awesome.
They tell me this is going to be a long road. I know I'm in good hands. I call them the dream team. I have a sense of confidence that my personality will carry me through this. I have to remain positive for my family and my friends. Maybe I'm in denial of how serious this is. My doctor won't use stats with me, but the odds are stacked against me still. Everybody's calling me a hero, saying that I'm so brave and an inspiration. I appreciate their kind words, but that's not how I see myself. The only thing I've done is make a choice to follow a treatment plan. I've made the choice that I want to continue living, but that's an easy choice.
Come on, come on.
there, it's actually got a lot of north in it, but here it's got the...
Okay, you just taking a quick break to look at things? And...
Well, I'll grab some meat too.
Okay.
Watch the side gust because it tends to curry all over the road.
We come to the only remaining two-lane section of Highway 69. This road connects the south and the north and is defined by the Canadian Shield. Mike decides to stop in Point of Barrel for lunch and a break from the west wind. I introduce myself to Dennis Kennedy, who owns a local bait shop. He's a quiet man, but over time he opened up to me.
Now we're the only bait store on the highway from south of Barrie up to Sudbury. Well, one of my cooks, she lost her brother to cancer this year. She lost a sister to cancer this year. And her husband has lung cancer. So yeah, it's close.
I explained to Dennis that one of Mike's reasons for doing this trip is to promote the idea that nobody should go through something like this alone. I was a bit surprised that he was willing to open up to a complete stranger about his friends and family passing away, but part of me believes that people want to talk about these things, and that it's often easier to talk to a stranger, even when they're holding a camera.
My brother died 8 years ago. From skin cancer, can't remember what you call it. So yeah, I've had pretty close experiences with it. Yeah, it affects everybody one way or another.
September 9, 2013. I went to Goodwill with my dad today. On a cleaning spree, we sorted our VHS collection. He played a quick home video of me as a baby playing in a crib. I start to cry. I see a little girl, and I know what her future is going to be like. All I wanted to do was leap into the safety of the crib with her and protect her from everything. Maybe it's her I'm fighting for. I have to survive. This. Sometimes I catch myself standing still and staring into space. I think my body stops me so I can process all these thoughts. My reality is here. I have a 30% chance of surviving the next Weister.
Doing what I believe in.
I looked at him for a bit. I had a bit of a dream last night. It's more of a question. Do I need to fill out a will? I met a guy. I was looking for normalcy, so I went on a date. He's great. He didn't run when I said I had cancer. Thank you for seeing me for who I am.
Really me.
after all the wrong I've done, I guess you're surprised.
We arrive in Sudbury the next day. Sandy Cornell is a friend of Mike's from home. She's a breast cancer survivor, and she's come all this way to support the effort. I asked her about the difficulties in staying positive throughout treatment.
Even when I was so sick and I didn't have the strength to get out of the chair, I'd get out of the chair, I'd get dressed, and I always felt if I could walk from the house to the end of the driveway and back, that was good. And then I made it down the street and back, and then I actually made it up a hill and back. And all those just gave me hope and gave me the strength to keep going, because I still felt alive. It's losing control of your life. Each piece that you get that gives you back control after that diagnosis, the disease isn't controlling you anymore. You are controlling the disease. And I think that's a huge part of getting through this in a better way.
May 23rd, 2014. Today, I'm at PMH for my regular CT scan that happens every 3 months. I'm usually feeling pretty confident with these scans, as I've had great doctors and a positive attitude along the way. But this time, this one was different. Technically, the longer I'm in remission, the healthier I am, and the less likely my cancer will return. But the frightened and realistic part of me knows that cancer grows over time, and it's just a matter of time before it shows its ugly face again. In my heart, I know my scan will come back clear when I get the results on Tuesday, but my head is telling me otherwise. I'm almost expecting and preparing for the worst, so I'm not disappointed. Up, down, up, down, up, down. My feelings are always changing, but the most important thing that is consistent is the love and support from my friends and family. Thank you for being unconditionally patient with me as I grow and change through this journey. I love you. October 2nd, 2014. The cancer has spread to my lungs and liver. It's spreading fast. I don't know how much time I have left. I don't want to hurt more people. Justin is the best thing that's happened to me. This is the worst time to die. I try to convince him that he doesn't have to stay, that he doesn't have to experience this tragedy, that he can marry someone healthy and have a family. But he didn't listen. Instead, when the cancer got worse, he just held me tighter. His selflessness gave me hope.
if you talk to my wife or anybody in the family, it's I don't do this. This is not me. I keep it all bottled up and I deal with it, but I deal with it my way. In my case, I call it the asphalt therapist. I get out on the route, I process, I think about it, I go through the stuff. There's no rhyme or reason why it's her, or the person next to her, or the guy four blocks down the road, or the guy across the world. It doesn't matter. It's somebody got it, this time happened to be her. But then the other side of my brain is like, why does it have to be her? You know, why does it have to be my mom? Yeah, we're done. There you go. Legs want to lie down. So, how far did we get? Is the wrench right there, Dan? Get it? It wasn't too bad considering the weather conditions kind of were a little rough today, so they took a lot of energy out of me, but we didn't quite make 140, but we got to, I think we're just short of 130, so we'll call that a success for today.
No, I don't think I'd see myself riding a bike around Georgian Bay. It wouldn't be my cup of tea, but following Mike and doing what we're doing, helping fundraising and putting the word out with this project, I think it's a good cause, and that's why we're right on board. The whole family is. Well, he's pretty busy in the line of work that he's doing. It's probably clearing his mind too, and I guess he's even thinking of other ideas of how to design houses and whatever, but I think he's doing it in a big honor of his mom.
We set out on this journey to make a film about a man on what seemed like a simple mission to raise funds and awareness for his local cancer support center. But the people we met along the way changed everything. What we discovered was something so complex that we could only begin to understand it by listening to people talk about their experience. It's all too easy to simplify these stories and keep our distance. Along the way, we spoke to a judge, a nurse, a bait shop owner, a building designer, and many more, including a good friend of mine. And what binds them all together is their common grieving for what cancer has taken from them, and for what they have taken from it. I suppose we're all grieving somehow.
Can you hear me okay? Mm-hmm. All right. I finished my last dose of treatment today. I was a perfect candidate for the drug. Everybody thinks it's all done, a Hollywood ending, that this book has been closed. I beat the odds, but the truth is, I don't think this ever ends. So what now? My friend Dave reached out to me. He's making a film. He asked if I could help him understand all of this. Thank you.